Just remember in the winter, far beneath the bitter snow, lies the sea.
If you want to go ahead and stand up for me, as I take these cuffs off, just go ahead and put your hands down at the waist, okay? You know, these, especially these types of cuffs, aren't the most comfortable.
I don't think they're really designed for comfort.
Nope, they're not. Today's date is July 16th, and my name is Detective Rachel Blaney, and I'm here with Jody Arias. Is that how you say your last name?
Arias.
Okay, I'm sorry. This is just formality, and this is, you know, if I have to, you know, write up a report of what we talked about, at least I know word for word, you know, what you said, and there's no mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's for your own protection or good that
right.
We record it. And before we go any further, I need to read your Miranda rights again, just to make sure that you understand. You have the right to remain silent. Do you understand?
Yes.
Anything you say may be used against you in court. Do you understand?
Yes.
You have the right to the presence of an attorney before and during any questioning. Do you understand?
Yes.
If you cannot afford an attorney, one will be appointed for you free of charge before any questioning if you want. Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The reason that I wanted to talk with you this morning, there's a couple of reasons, actually. I have been privy to the investigation and all of the evidence in this case and to your conversation with Detective Flores yesterday. And There's really no, let me say this, it's obvious to me that, you know, you're not our typical suspect. You know, you come from a good home, a good family. Your parents obviously care about you. That was evident, you know, when they talked to him yesterday. And you're a bright girl. Probably more intelligent than you were letting on yesterday. And there's no question in my mind or any of the other investigators' mind that you were the person that took Travis's life. But what I need to know, or what I'd like to know, and give you the opportunity to do, is determine whether, you know, you're a cold-blooded, cold-hearted murderer who slaughtered this guy, or are you somebody that got caught up in circumstances and things got out of control? Because I think that is what happened, honestly, in looking at everything and all of the facts and in talking to people. You know, I think in every person that anybody could be capable of harming another person. I think it's in our nature, and generally most people suppress that. But I think given the right circumstances and, you know, the right time and the right place, anybody could be, you know, capable of harming another person. I see that on a regular basis. What I generally see are the cold-hearted, ruthless types. What I don't see very often, Jody, are people like yourself that are intelligent and spiritual and caring. And so I tend to believe that it was an incident of circumstance, if you will. It looks as if, you know, this guy, Travis, you know, befriended you, he got into this relationship, and it certainly looks to me like he took advantage of your generosity and your kindness. You know, one of the other detectives had described him to you as a player. And I don't think that that's very far off from everything that I've seen. And I don't think there's a woman out there that hasn't been treated badly or taken advantage of by a man like that. And I'm hoping, because you come from a good family and because you have a decent background, I'm hoping that you'll be smart about things and make some choices for yourself to help better your situation. When this hits the news, and it will, it'll go to the media, do you want to be portrayed as that cold-blooded, cold-hearted murderer? Because the media loves that. That's not, you know, that won't be our words or their words when they do a press release, but that's what, you know, the media will take a look at the facts and that's what they'll portray it as. Or do you want to be portrayed as a person that didn't mean to have any of this happen, it just got out of hand and you're remorseful? You know, which way do you want to go? How do you want to portray yourself? You're a businesswoman, is that correct? Okay. And you have a couple of different businesses going, right? So you're a smart girl, Jody. Smart woman. You got to have a lot on the ball to be, you know, your own businesswoman and balancing everything the way you do, because it sounds like you got a lot going on and a lot of juggling and balancing. You're obviously very organized. Well-read.
I would say well-read, but not organized.
Not organized? Why so?
I procrastinate, so things, papers pile up, and things don't get filed on time, and I lose stuff, and then I find it later when I don't need it anymore. You know, when I do need it, I can't find it, so.
Okay.
Just general stuff like that.
Well, maybe you're not as organized as I had thought. It's certainly
well,
human.
I try. I mean, I go through these periods where it's like, today is devoted to organization, and then I'll get organized, and
mm-hmm.
it'll be that way for a little while, and I'll kind of let it slide, and then I'll have to go back and clean up again.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, I think that, you know, the reason you're here is I think that you should have the just at least one more shot at, you know, the opportunity to do the right thing. You know, you say that you're spiritual, or those are my words, not yours, but that's certainly what I got out of, you know, reading everything and looking at everything, that, you know, you have some sort of relationship with God, or, you know, some sort of deep spirituality, and so did Travis. And it sounds like, you know, you cared about what Travis's family thought of him. Maybe what they thought of you. I don't know whether you ever met them.
I met his grandmother.
Okay.
A few times.
Were they good people?
Yeah, wonderful. And I didn't meet his family at his services, but I saw some of his sisters, and he talked about them a lot. And he talked about how proud he was of all of his brothers and sisters, because they come from a rough background, but they've all done really well.
Mm-hmm. I would imagine that keeping all of this in, I can only imagine because I've never been there myself, but I can only imagine that keeping all of this in is just tearing you apart inside. It's not hard to tell that, you know, you have portrayed yourself as being very strong, but you can see it in your eyes, Jody.
It's not like, you know, it's not that my dad said that Detective Flores told him that I was just cold yesterday, and it's not that I'm cold. I'm just resolute, and it's not that I haven't cried. It's all I've done for the last month,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I've got to go to work part-time, and at my job I need to be a happy, cheery person, so I've got to suppress all of that and put on an act while I'm on the clock.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm going to get any more clients for my business, I've got to be an attractive person in my personality, so it's not like I haven't been grieving him since I heard about him.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, you have an image. I understand that. You have an image to uphold, and you have to portray, you know, that you're a together, savvy woman. You know, not somebody who's fallen apart. So that's understandable.
But fall apart when you aren't looking, and when it's at night and I go to sleep. Travis always used to call me. Not always, but very frequently, so that's the hardest part, is when I go to sleep at night, and if he wasn't calling, then I'd just call him, and sometimes I would just call anyway, just to hear his voicemail.
So let me go back to, you know, the choices that you have, because again, there's no doubt in anybody's mind what happened that day. There's no doubt that you were involved that day that Travis died.
Listen, I know that I wasn't involved in Travis's death.
Okay.
And...
But what we... Hold on. What you need to decide is, do you want to be portrayed as that cold-blooded killer?
Oh, that's what I was getting at.
Or do you want to be portrayed as somebody that was taken advantage of and... you know, things, just one thing led to another. You thought your relationship was headed in one direction and it wasn't, or, you know, I don't know exactly the circumstances because I wasn't there, but I would certainly think that it's to your benefit to appear as this is something that just happened. You didn't plan it. It was, you know, it was a heated moment, and you didn't mean to hurt him, because you didn't mean to hurt him, did you?
I've hurt him very much emotionally, and I never meant to hurt him.
Okay.
He said that
so,
I hurt him more than the death of his father.
And I believe that. You know, how are you going to come clean with yourself, you know, between you and God, if you can't even, you know, look his family in the face and show remorse? I don't think that you're a bad person. I don't think that you meant any of this to happen. I think that things got out of control and you didn't know what to do and you panicked. And I would certainly like your parents to see that, your friends to see that, instead of the cold-hearted killer that the evidence is screaming to show. And this is, you know, at a certain point, you gotta do what's right. You know, you gotta make things right for yourself. Because otherwise it's going to eat inside of you. You're going to be sitting in that cell with all of this churning inside of you, and it's going to eat you up. And just because I'm a cop doesn't mean that I don't care, you know, about humanity and people. You know, I'm not sitting here judging you. I'm trying to help you out. I'm trying to give you a chance to make things right. You know, show the families that you do have some remorse. You know, apologize for the things that you've done if that's what makes you feel better, you know, whatever it is. But when you continue to deny, 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 when it's obvious that that's not the case, you appear to be the cold-blooded killer. You know, and the media is going to feed off of that. You know, when this goes to trial, the media is there. It's not kept secret. You know, do you want to be out there in like the O.J. Simpsons? Because nobody felt sorry for him. You know, nobody respected him afterwards, even though he maintained his innocence. How do you want to be portrayed? Do you want to be portrayed as the person that you are, the, you know, a decent person who's had some tough times and you know, just didn't make the right choices at the time? Or do you want to be portrayed as a person that doesn't care about anybody or anything?
You know, of course I don't want to be portrayed as a cold-blooded murderer.
I believe that. I believe that everybody wants to tell the truth, because to keep that lie in tears you up emotionally, physically, mentally. I see that over and over and over again with people. And I believe that you don't want to be portrayed in the negative light that I've already. And I'm not making that stuff up. I mean, that's just reality, Jody. That's the way our society works. That's the way this world works. And things are going to start moving real fast here for you. This is kind of a pause, you know, before things, you know, start getting heavy. This is your opportunity to help yourself out. When the jury looks at it, those are the things that they're going to be mulling around in their mind when they decide what type of sentence to hand out, or when they make a recommendation to the judge. Those are the sorts of things that turn a jury. And the juries sometimes can be fickle, but I've never seen a case with so much concrete, hard evidence. We don't need you to tell us anything. I'm doing this for you. Arizona's case goes no matter what. They've got a rock solid case. So what you say is basically irrelevant to their case. Not irrelevant, but it's not going to make it any better for them. But it certainly can help you out.
How can it help me? I mean, how can what I tell you today affect the media?
You take control of the situation as much as you can and paint whatever kind of picture you want to paint of yourself. Nobody's going to believe that you didn't do it after they see the evidence. It's just, it is what it is. But it's a matter of, do you want to take control of your situation and paint the picture of who you are, because you're the only one that knows that? Or do you want the media to take the evidence, all of the facts and the information, and paint their own picture of you? And as smart as you are, you know as well as I do that the media doesn't like to paint warm and fuzzy pictures. They would much rather paint the vicious, cold-blooded killer, because that sells. Am I right? So, do you want to control your situation? Paint your own picture? Or do you want to let somebody else do that for you?
I don't feel like I have any control over what the media says anyway.
Well, you do, to a certain degree. You can have the opportunity to tell your side of the story. You know, was it a matter of, like I said, this guy, Travis, building some sort of, what you thought was some sort of relationship? You know, were you hoping for marriage? Because I've heard a lot of talk about, you know, possibilities of marriage, and I know that that is, you know, a cornerstone of your faith. Is marriage and family, is this something that you were hoping for? Was he leading you down that path? You know, did he take advantage of you? Were there promises made that were broken? Did he betray your trust in some way? I don't know. Only you know that. But certainly if that was the situation, they would look at you in a better light than if you just went in there and just killed the guy just cause you're a cold-hearted person. You know, the reasons why are what's going to give you a better portrayal, a better light that you're portrayed in. That's why the reasons why are so important to you, and that's how you can take control. When you leave Siskiyou County and go back to Arizona, which eventually you will, whether you fight the extradition or not, that's just kind of
an inevitability.
It's going to happen eventually. You're not going to have the opportunity to do this again. And I'm certainly, not going back to Arizona. I won't have the opportunity, and the shot will be gone.
What is your role, though? I mean, you're a detective.
Mm-hmm. This is our jurisdiction. It's our county. So, part of this investigation, if you will, is on us. So I've taken an interest in this case. You know, I saw you and I read all this information, and I'm like, man, she's not the typical person that we see in here.
Can I ask you a couple questions?
Sure.
Not personal questions. I know I understand they took some of my stuff yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Where does all that go? Does it go to Arizona?
It'll be transferred to Arizona. It's held in evidence. There's a list of everything that was taken, and a copy of that was left at each.
At each location. And it was a carbon copy, so my parents couldn't read it all. My grandparents couldn't read everything. They told me some of the things, and some of the things were like my camera, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Just fine, I understand that. My concern is other people. For example, I'm a wedding photographer, and I just did a wedding on Friday. And I feel bad for Brian and his wife, Katie, because those are their wedding pictures. That's all they have for their wedding. And I just want to know when they'll be able to get their wedding.
I don't know when. I don't know how, this could go on for
quite
a while.
That's the only thing they have to remember the day.
They're not going to destroy the wedding pictures. They're not going to get rid of them or anything like that.
And I just take pride in my work, and I guess, I'm not going to have a chance to edit them and make them really beautiful. Like, they already turned out really good, but, like Photoshop, I just do all kinds of neat effects, and they turn out like magic. And so that won't be the case this time, but at least the hard files were there for them, And, you know, if they're not going to get them forever and ever, it's going to suck for them. But as long as they get them eventually.
They'll get them eventually.
And also I'm...
I think that, you know... Go ahead.
My sister... I don't know what her problem is. I mean, she's far less messed up than I am, I guess. But she's in a program right now in Klamath Falls. For... till the end of August. Rehabilitating from something. And my mom, we write her, you know, we only get to talk to her once a week, and my mom is going to send pictures, because I have on my external drive, I have a bunch of pictures of her and I that we just were doing this with, just taking pictures of each other on her prom night, because I helped her do her hair, and I helped her, you know, just take pictures, and then I dropped her off, and she just wanted some of those to have. If she's all done up glamorous and she's like, I can't remember what I look like without makeup. And I did a photo shoot with my little brother last week, and they turned out really good, and she wanted those pictures too. She doesn't have access to any of them now. And those are all family treasures. And I did that, of course, because it's for them, and it's, you know. But I would have made her a CD, but my CD-ROM just wasn't working right. And I just didn't get around to making it because I didn't have the proper tools to do it. And she just wants those to mail to Angela.
Well, see, these are the sorts of things that, you know, paint a picture of a good, decent person where things just went a little wrong. You know, you showing so much concern and care.
Do you know what happened to my journals, too?
You know, I wasn't there when
they... I know they said they took one. I don't know if they took my other ones.
Where were your other ones at?
In my fireproof safe.
Okay. I'm not sure. There's a... They have a hard copy, you know, an actual copy, an original copy, that...
If you want my journals, it documents the entire time starting from when I moved to Arizona up until 2 or 3 days ago.
Where's that safe at? Is that
it's
at your...
It's under my bed. They said they looked through it.
Okay. Well, then, if there was anything...
I don't know if they, know, felt they felt it was relevant, necessary. But...
You know,
I'm sure there's Travis got a lot of ink in my journals. I don't know. It doesn't matter now because I know you guys think what you think, but
it's not you know, the job of the detectives, any detective, is to determine, you know, what happened, whether a person, you know, is there evidence that would clear you, evidence that would convict you, etc. We're totally neutral going in, and it's not a matter of, you know, our opinion and what we think. It's a matter of taking a look at all of the evidence and knowing. And, you know, I think you're not grasping the reality of this situation. And hearing, you know, what your concerns are, you should be concerned for yourself right now. You should be fighting for yourself. This is not going to go away anytime soon for you, Jody. You know? You're a young woman, just starting your life. You had a lot going for you. You should be fighting for yourself right now.
There's really nothing to fight for. If I fight, it just makes me look worse.
If you fight,
and if I give you some false confession, that just makes it look just as bad.
No,
there's really nothing.
We don't want a false confession. That's absolutely not what anybody ever wants, ever. I was just hoping to give you the opportunity to show the world, to show the community, to show the jury, to show Travis's family that you do have a heart, that you do care, that you are a good person. And maybe things went askew that day. I'm giving you scenarios with what happened that day because I wasn't there. I don't know, you know, the emotions that led up to it. There was obviously a lot of emotion. That's very clear. There was a lot of emotion that day in what happened. And so I'm trying, it's kind of like pulling teeth here. I'm trying to give you the opportunity to help yourself, to show the world, to show the community, to show Travis's family that you do have remorse, that you are a good person. And that doesn't benefit me in any way. I get no benefit out of this. You know, my job pays the same whether I'm sitting here or at home, whatever. I was trying to give you that opportunity. And I asked if I could talk to you today to do that. Makes no difference to me. Not personally. But it sure can make a difference for you. And you let this eat at you, and it's going to destroy you or change you in a way that you wouldn't want. And it comes a time in somebody's life, there's always a pinnacle in somebody's life where you have the opportunity to define who you are. Do you want the murder of Travis to define who you are? Or do you want to take control of that and do it yourself? Everybody makes mistakes, some bigger than others. And I think this is the time in your life. I'm trying to tell you, this is the time, Jody. This is the time to take control more than you've ever done before. At least show the people that you love and care about that you have remorse and that you have a heart. Because when they sit there and they see somebody that's just stone cold and saying they didn't do it when it's clear to everybody that you did, that's what they're going to see, is a stone cold person. This is your opportunity to change that. You can't change what happened. You can't go back and undo it. It's a done deal. But hopefully you're smart enough to realize that you can have a little bit of control of how you're portrayed. I don't think that you're a bad person. I don't think that you meant to hurt him. I think that you really cared about him and that you loved him. And that's why there was so much emotion in that day. I'm not sure of the circumstances, the conversations that led up to it. I can only see the result. I think that things got a little heated. You know, were angry or upset or disappointed, or betrayed, whatever the emotion was. And things got out of control.
We both have betrayed each other, but it was so long ago, you know? The last time we even talked about marriage on a serious level was when we were still dating over a year ago. Mm-hmm. And the last time, you know, he proposed to me once, he proposed to me a lot of times, but he wasn't always serious. Mm-hmm. Just kind of said it, marry me, you know, as a joke.
And how did that make you feel when he said marry me as a joke? I mean, did you want it?
Not after we had broken up. It was kind of like laughs. Like, it's really kind that he would joke like that. We would laugh, mm-hmm. You know. And I took it as a compliment because it's when I did something that maybe in his eyes he saw me as a good person. Mm-hmm. And so he'd be like, wow, this is a good girl, marry me. But it was more of a compliment. It wasn't mm-hmm. a serious proposal. You know, so marriage, as much as I love Travis, I just have always, there's something inside that says he's not the guy you're going to marry.
So then what was it? What was it that led up to all of this? I mean, there's got to be something. So I honestly don't believe that, you know, that you're cold-hearted and you would just go and just, you know, kill somebody on a whim. That doesn't fit your profile. So what was it that led up to that? You know, you tell me. You tell them. You tell, you know, Travis's family. What was it that, you know, pushed you to your limit? I'm just trying to fill in the holes there, you know, and just kind of guessing about the emotions. You know, what was it that would make you, you know, so angry or upset? And if you're smart, you'll realize that, you know, you're not going to get a whole lot of other chances to do this. Probably none. Once the wheels start turning, they move real fast. And you will be out of control then. You won't have control over your destiny, so to speak. You know, what about your spirituality and your beliefs with God? You know, if you continue to lie to yourself and all of us, that's one thing, but God knows. He knows what's in your heart. Doesn't the Mormon religion want you to repent for what you've done? You know, I'm a spiritual person myself, and I don't think that I would want that, you know, inside of me. I wouldn't want all of the ugliness of the lies inside of me. And I'm not going to sit here all day, you know, and try to convince you to do something for yourself if you're not willing to help yourself. But I just wanted to give you that chance this morning. It's clear, it's crystal clear to anybody who looks at this case. There is no doubt in my mind, there's no doubt in any of the investigators' mind, that you are the person responsible for Travis's death. It's just a matter of, how do you want to portray yourself now, Jody? Are you the cold-blooded killer, or are you a victim of circumstance? Was it in the heat of passion, or was it calculated and planned out and executed? Which one is it going to be? That's how you can control things for yourself right now. I don't think you're the type of person that can sit there during a trial and see Travis's family sitting over there and continue to maintain that lie in yourself without it tearing you up.
I don't think I could either.
You have an opportunity. You can't bring him back. You can't bring his life back. But you can at least make things right within yourself. And that ultimately is going to probably help out your situation. Nobody wants to believe, even, you know, your friends, I'm sure. I haven't talked to any of your friends, but I know that your family doesn't want to believe that you're that person. Help them understand what happened and why, so that they're not stuck with that image of you.
The only image they're going to be stuck with is Jody in a big orange suit.
Yeah, but does Jody have a heart, or is it cold and ice?
They know it's like what my heart is like. They raised me, and they've lived around me forever.
How about the rest of the people that just know you as far as an image, that doesn't know you personally? Do you care about that?
I care.
How about Travis's family?
I care very much about Travis's family, and I can't alter the way they think. They hate me regardless.
It's true that their feelings are probably always going to be negative about you. You know, you took their son's life. They can never get over that.
I want to take Travis's life.
It's clear to everybody what happened, But I was hoping that you were smart enough to realize the situation, the reality of the situation, and wanted to help yourself out. Whether you want to maintain the charade, which isn't going to get you anywhere, or whether you want to do the right thing. You're the one that's got to live with yourself, you know. You're the one that's got to look those people in the eye.
I have one more question. It's not that I haven't been listening to what you're saying. It's unrelated. But when I took my purse, I had $240 in cash. And from what I understand, this thing over in the jail, you can have money on your books so that you can get things like shampoo or whatever. Mm-hmm. I don't know what I would even need there. But what happens to my cash?
Well, it's, first of all, they count it all out and document it, so there's no question of, you know, what was there. I don't know what the procedure is.
I know
is.
It's not really, maybe it's not your area or your responsibility, but who do I talk to about that? Because my parents don't have money to just keep doling out and making the collect calls there all the time or whatever, so.
Well, I can certainly talk with the detectives and put in a request for you, and I'll do that. I don't go back on my words. And I don't know how much longer, you know, you want to sit here and listen to me talking, but I was hoping to kind of drill something into your head and wake you up and show you how you can help yourself.
Maybe you're giving me more credit than I deserve for being smart.
I don't think
but
so.
I just don't see how any of that could help.
What if it could? Wouldn't you want to do everything you could to help yourself?
I don't. I think that my situation is hopeless, and I don't think that I can help myself.
Don't be sorry to me. Are you sorry for what happened to him?
Of course I am. That's awful what happened to him. He
did you ever
show me any pictures, but he showed me the carpet.
It was pretty horrific.
You know, Travis was very strong. I watched him work out a couple of times. It's super intense. My dad has worked out all my life. He's been bodybuilder, sort of, not professional. It's just always been really big, and I've seen him work out, but I've never seen anyone work out like Travis. And it's he's just, you know, a couple times he was really into UFC, and a couple times he would show me some wrestling moves, and I was just powerless. There's no way out of it.
Well, I tell you what, I'm gonna take a break for a couple of minutes. I see if you still got some water. I was gonna give you some more water.
Yeah, if you could bring one more, that'd be nice.
Take a minute just to think about what I said. And I'll leave you alone while I do that.
All right.
Jody. I'm really confused. Maybe I did have a wrong picture of you. You know, all of this time that you and I have been talking, and I got information from your other interview, you are talking about insignificant things at this point. You're talking about money, you're talking about material things, you're talking about everything, but
I'm just talking you're about talking about that just people I care about.
You're talking about everything but how bad you feel about Travis. You only respond to my questions.
If I murdered Travis, I would be very remorseful.
I think that I've gotten the wrong picture of you. I think that, you know, maybe I was wrong. Maybe you are that cold-blooded person that they're trying to portray. And, you know, I'm just really confused. At this point, you know, maybe you're right. Maybe there isn't anything that you can do to help yourself. You know, maybe I was wrong. Maybe you're not as intelligent as I thought you were. Maybe I was wrong. What do you think should happen to the person that murdered Travis?
You know, I've never been one for an eye for an eye, but they took his life. And even the Book of Mormon says that that calls for the life of the person that took his life.
Do you think that's the path that you're going down right now, and it's inevitable, so why fight it?
I'm not sure, kind of, but I'm not sure. I don't know where I'm going.
So, tell me this. After looking at all the evidence, and what I think is crystal clear, if you didn't kill Travis, then who did?
He was private about a lot of aspects of his life.
Mm-hmm.
He told me some things. Some things I got from some of his, you know, Facebook account, email account, or MySpace or whatever. Because I had the passwords to those. But I don't know. Like, occasionally he would get solicitations, but and he would always respond, not to answer the solicitation, but to kind of call a person out. And I don't know if anything ever came of those. I don't know. I know his tires were slashed. I don't know.
Maybe you weren't the person that did it. Maybe you just were physically there when it happened and somebody else did it. I mean, I guess, you know, that's a possibility. If that's the case, you know, help us out here. Help yourself out. You know, I don't know what else to do for you here, Jody. I'm kind of at the end of my rope. You're not going to get a whole lot of people that are trying to help you out along the way beyond this point. If you didn't do it, then who did? Because everything is pointing to you. Not just pointing to you, but, you know, screaming that Jody killed Travis. And I thought that I could come in here and talk to you and talk some, you know, sense into you and get you to, you know, kind of help yourself out. You don't need to help our case out. You don't need to help their case out. That's a slam dunk.
I know, he showed me.
And what I'm hearing is somebody who doesn't give a rip about what happened. I'm hearing somebody that's worried about money, your appearance, everything about you. I don't hear anything about Travis unless you're specifically asked. How do you think that looks?
Listen, I don't care so much.
No,
about
you listen. You are not grasping the reality here, Jody. you know, you're worried about wedding pictures and, you know, all this other stuff that is really insignificant.
Well, listen, my life is over. Travis's life is over. I'm sorry about Travis. I didn't take his life.
All right. Well, I guess I was wrong.
The reason I cared about those other things is because those people still have lives, and I care about those people. And I just, they don't know where their stuff is, you know? I happen to be in possession of their stuff. And so,
all I know is all of the innocent people that I've talked to that have been accused of a crime don't act the way that you do. And you are acting like the person that I portrayed, the ugly, cold-blooded murderer, one of the options that I portrayed. That is how you're acting. There is nothing in your actions that would indicate to me that you're the victim of circumstance. And you're going to be sorry, you know, when you get down the road
I agree.
You'll probably be sorry that you didn't do the right thing. You have an opportunity to do something right here. I don't know what to tell you. Show me that I wasn't wrong, Jody. Show me what's inside your heart and not what's on the exterior. Help me understand why it happened and that it wasn't cold and calculated and planned. Because that's how everything points right now. You owe that at least to Travis's family. Give them some closure. Because I know, just from working with all these families that have lost loved ones, that they're not struggling with who did it, they're struggling with why.
That's what I've been struggling with.
Do you not understand why you did it yourself, maybe? Is it something that, you know, is it a part of you that came forth that you've never seen before? I don't know. I know Travis's family is struggling with why, and that would be the one thing that would give them closure. They may never like you, but I think that they would be appreciative of why their son's life was taken. You can't give them their son back, but you can at least give them the peace of mind as to why. I know if it was my child, that's what I would want. And I know that you're not a mother, but all women have those mothering instincts within them, and I think that you can understand that, what I'm saying. And that's why you're hanging your head right now. Was I off base, Jody?
can't imagine what it would be like to lose one of my brothers.
Wouldn't you want to know why you lost one of your brothers? I've never met them, I can't speak for them, but I would bet, you know, my paycheck, that that's what they're wondering right now. And you can at least show that you have a soul, that you have a heart, that you understand that need in them, and do something for somebody else besides yourself. That's the least that you can do for them right now, is give them an answer. Tell them why. That's how you can control something that's happening in your life right now. Because you have all the power there. It's a gift that you can give that family. Them why. Use me as the voice to tell them why.
I just don't know why.
Did one thing lead to another and it just got out of hand? And it's unexplainable even in your mind? Or did you have it all planned out? You know, was he roughing you up and you just couldn't take it anymore? You know, was he being violent on his part?
He was only that way a couple times. It was before I moved. And people just, I had bruises and stuff, but people were like, oh, is Travis beating you up? And we're like, ha ha ha. And he got mad because I wore a short sleeve shirt, but it was like 100 degrees outside.
So, this isn't the perfect picture of a relationship that you've been trying.
No, it was very rocky. I've never once denied that we had our challenges. Like, he's said several choice words to me that weren't nice, and you know, but he's not the only person that's ever done that. My own father has done that.
Yeah.
You know, other women and men have done that to me, and other boyfriends.
But you didn't kill them. You didn't get pushed to the point where, you know, you couldn't take it anymore. That's what we're trying to understand. That's why. Either way, those detectives in Arizona have their case made. But the least you can do for that family is give them an answer. I'm not saying portray Travis as this ugly, horrible person, because, you know, I don't know that that's the right thing to do either. But at least let them know that it was a two-way street and it wasn't all your fault. Or, like I said, maybe I'm wrong and maybe it was. Maybe you did plan it from day one and carried it out. If his mom and dad were sitting here right now, what would you say to them?
I would tell them I'm very sorry.
never lost anyone that's close to me.
If they asked you why it happened, what would you say to them?
I don't have an answer for why. I don't know why he was killed. I don't know why.
All right. Maybe you can't understand why. But what led up to it? What would you say to them? Because that would help them with the why. If you're struggling with the why within yourself, then what led up to it? Could you explain to his mom and dad what led up to it that would help them understand? Are you saying that to me or are you saying that to his family?
To everybody. To his family, to my family. To Travis.
Then if you truly are sorry, Jody, clear your conscience and give them an understanding of what led up to it. Don't paint yourself as the cold-blooded person that they'll be left with unless you give them an understanding. I don't want to believe that I was wrong about you. I can see that your tears are real. That obviously is nothing that you can fake.
I know Travis told me that my tears mean nothing. I said that one time when we were fighting.
How did that make you feel?
Well, I knew they were real, so that's all I'm at. It just made me, I don't know, it was weird, because sometimes he just seemed to have no emotional understanding or depth, and then other times he could move himself to cry like that if he wanted to, or if he was on stage, and it made him, it, you know, helped his speech or whatever. But those were things that he felt deeply about, you know?
So we're all different.
We all express our emotions differently, and I realized that.
Did he know how to push your buttons?
We knew how to push each other's buttons. I could make him mad in 5 seconds. It's not my favorite pastime or anything, but I just knew how to do that, and he knew how to make me cry in 5 seconds. So I think his emotional expression was anger, and mine was just sadness, I guess.
Is that what happened? Did he push your buttons or you push his buttons? Is that what triggered this whole thing?
No.
Because looking at the pictures, it looked like that, you know, you guys were engaged in some sort of intimate moment between the two of you. It didn't look like it was all going bad. It looked like, you know, something happened real quick. And that's the understanding that I was talking about, that you could give to the family. Well, maybe you don't know why, and I understand, you know, that's a pretty deep philosophical thing that you'll be, you know, struggling with within yourself, I'm guessing. But you know the factual things that led up to it. And then, you know, people can draw their own conclusions from there. But sitting there silent and not saying anything makes you look like a horrible person. I mean, obviously, you've had other relationships with, you know, ups and downs that never drove you to that point.
They were far worse than Travis.
So what was it? What was it with Travis that set you off to such a degree? I understand that you're a very private person. Everybody has said that, and that's glaringly apparent. But all your business is going to be out in the open right now, so there's really nothing to hide from anymore. You know what I mean?
How is it as private as Travis?
Are you worried about his reputation? Is that what you're trying to protect here?
Yeah, I mean, I'm concerned to an extent. I don't want him to, I would rather everyone didn't know that he was, that we were both violating certain chastity laws continually. That's it's a very big deal in the church.
Yeah.
I mean, I know that his bishop knows, but he keeps everything private. And, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with our faith, but Travis has another bishop now, you know, in the next life. He's working through those things. So he's got his own path. I don't want his family to, I don't know, I don't think all of his family share his faith, or if they do, they're not as involved deeply as he was. So I don't know how they would feel. I'm sure they don't care. They just want to know why. Can't imagine what they're going through.
So, I mean, at least on some level you can understand what's going on in their head. The why is what we've been talking about. Was this a situation where you guys were involved in an intimate exchange and things got too rough? Is that why the secrecy and the privacy with me today? And what's keeping you from unloading your burden? Is it your own pride? Do you think at this point that your pride matters more than Travis's family's grief? You know, what if they don't have a faith base like Travis did? And what if they don't have a spirituality to fall back on to help them through this process? You know, some people can deal with it better when they have their own spiritual roots that they can dig down and hold on to. What if they don't have that? You know, what if they're in more turmoil than somebody who did have a faith base? Wouldn't you want to help them out? I mean, you tell me that you're sorry.
If I could, I would help them in a heartbeat.
Well, you know that you can't bring him back. But you can help them understand. And no matter what you say, it's not gonna change their love for their son. It's not gonna make them dislike their son, no matter what happened. But at least they'll have closure. At least they'll have closure. If you're not going to do it for yourself, at least do it for them. If you've already resigned to the fact that your situation is hopeless, why wouldn't you do that for them?
That's a good question. I think I will.
use the restroom?
Sure.
You understand that I have to go in there with you?
It's fine.
Okay. So before we took a break, I posed the question to you that you felt was a good question. If your situation, if you see your situation as so hopeless, why wouldn't you at least give the family some closure and some peace of mind as to what happened or why?
I'm strongly valuing and you have a good.
If you have any feelings, emotions within you, if you have any goodness in your heart, I don't know why you wouldn't do that. Because if you don't, and you don't give them the information that they seek for the closure, that makes you a very selfish person. Have you been selfish?
Just a lot of ways. Travis was always so selfless. He gave me everything that I needed. If I needed money and he had it, it was mine. If I needed food, if I needed to borrow his car, to use the internet because mine was down. Anything. I needed to. If I wanted to borrow any books, he had a cool library. Or audio books. One time he helped me with my prepaid legal business. And he doesn't benefit monetarily in the least from it. And I would help him too with that each month, because you have to qualify for his position. It's a monthly qualification. Sometimes I would just help him with computer stuff. But I think I'm selfish. And one time we just met in Ehrenberg when I lived in Southern California. So we could just rent a hotel room and make out the whole weekend. And whatever. But we drove to go see a movie, and there was this lady standing with a sign. He pulls over in his BMW and pulls down his window and said, "Are you hungry?" And she said, "Yeah." So we turned around and went to the Wendy's right next to the hotel. And he got her this triple decker and the biggie fries or whatever it's called, and the biggest drink that they had, and gave it to her. He always did stuff like that. We pulled into this gas station once in Chinle, Arizona. It's all just Navajo Indians. And nothing against that tribe. They've got a very rich culture, but most Navajos that you meet today are really overweight. And but they have their animals are starving. Everywhere you go, they got ribs sticking out. It used to make us both so bad. So Travis bought. We ended up splitting it, but Travis bought 7 cheeseburgers for 300 hungry dogs. And one was a mother, puppies, and they just wolfed them down. We felt better, but we just felt like we couldn't do enough.
Then where did things go wrong, Jody?
I don't know.
This is your chance to make at least something right. Even if it's on a small scale, it's a big deal to his folks.
Do they already know I'm in custody?
I'm sure they do.
Should they feel better about that much?
But they still need closure. I mean, just because you're in custody doesn't give them any closure. Is this something that you planned from day one? Is this something that you wish you could take back?
I wish I could change it. I wish I could rewind the clock.
What would you do if you rewound the clock?
I would have done everything I could to prevent it.
If your fate is inevitable in your mind, why wouldn't you give the family closure?
Give them what they want.
Wouldn't you at least want to try and let them make that decision? If it were my son, I would want all of the information I could so that I could make some sense of it. Is something that is so horrific in your mind that you don't even want to think that you could be capable of such a thing? So, you know, that's the person that I was talking about, the person that is scared and remorseful and didn't want any of this to happen. I don't think I was wrong, Jody. This is your opportunity to make right on some of your selfishness. And let the family decide how they're going to deal with that information and how they're going to use it. Why should they have any more suffering than they've already had? In your religion, and forgive me for my ignorance about it.
It's mostly just a Christian-based religion.
Do they believe that the truth shall set you free?
I think, yeah, because it has to do with repentance.
Mm-hmm. And if it's just a Christian-based theology, then I would say they would.
I think it even says that in the Doctrine and Covenants, which is another part of our scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Try to remember if I just read that the other day.
Have you been giving much thought to that?
Not within the last 24 hours. I haven't really been thinking about a lot, except
you are the only person that has the information that the family seeks. They don't seek, you know, crime scene information. They will already have that. They seek something that is on a much deeper level. It's an emotional level. And you are the only person that can help them with that.
wasn't angry at Travis. Everyone keeps saying whoever did this was so angry.
Then what were you? Were you scared? Were you jealous?
I remember feeling jealous when we were together, because this one time, especially when he was letting this drunk girl hang all over him, and he wasn't doing anything to stop it, he was just supporting her and holding her, and like right in front of me, like, what are you doing? But I didn't want to make a scene, you know, all our friends were there, so I just left. I felt more sad, but there were, of course, more feelings of insecurity, because it made me wonder, what are your deeper philosophies if you think that's okay and we're in our relationship together? And to him, it was harmless. And I realized that he didn't mean anything by it. We talked about it. So I remember feeling jealous about that. That was almost a year and a half ago.
So if it's not jealousy and it's not anger, then what was it? Have you been asking yourself that same question? Is it that you're having a hard time figuring it out within yourself? Was it fear? So if it was fear, then what is it that you're afraid of, or were afraid of? Are you looking back and trying to remember that day?
I'm just trying to remember everything. Like things that happened or conversations. Like I just.
What do you remember about that day that would help the family understand? Did you at least start out enjoying each other's company that day? Did you go there with the intention to kill him? No. What was your intention? Did you mean for that to happen?
Really good at expressing myself. I think I'm just gonna write his family a letter.
Would you like to write him a letter now?
I think I want to. I mean, I could start, but it would just be like a rough draft. It wouldn't be something that I'm ready to submit. I wouldn't. I want to think about it and make sure that that's what I really want to say, and I know that you want everything now, but and if you don't want to do that or help me anymore, that's fine, but I'm still going to write him a letter, I think.
Well, I think that's a good idea for you to write him a letter. As far as the now goes for me, like I said, it's not going to make any difference for me. But it would make a difference for you, and it would make a difference for Travis's family. Because I think I'm very safe in my assumption that they're seeking closure. And the more information that they have to understand why will give them the closure that they seek. And I think that you want to do that. I can see that in you. They do deserve that. If you have a hard time expressing yourself, you know, that's okay and understandable in this situation. This isn't an everyday, average, normal situation.
I can usually see things better in writing.
If you would let me help you, I can help you with that expression. But you have to be willing. And you can still write him a letter. And the least you can do is give the family something. I don't know how many times I can say that enough. You say that you didn't mean for that to happen that day. You nodded your head no when I asked you that. And I believe that. But in order for it to be believable, there has to be some understanding as what led up to it. Was he expecting you to come over that day?
He wanted me to. I told him I wasn't going to.
So was it a surprise that you actually showed up? Is it a matter of you not understanding how things got so carried away that it would end up in a situation like that?
I don't know.
Or did you go there with the intention to kill him? Do you want to leave here today with those questions unanswered for Travis's mom and dad?
His mom and dad passed away. But I know you don't say that to be like trivial. Just when you say that, in my mind I go, they understand because they're all together.
I see. So who's left behind? His grandmother?
She raised him. He has a lot of brothers and sisters. I think he has 3 sisters, maybe 4. Tanisha, Samantha. I don't remember. And he has some brothers. A big brother and a little brother.
So what about his grandma and siblings? Do you want to walk away from here today without giving them something to understand? If your fate is sealed in your mind, why wouldn't you give them that? And at the same time, help yourself out. Are you the cold-hearted person that everybody thinks you are?
No, not cold-hearted.
Then what are you?
Weak.
What is your weakness?
Kind of embarrassed.
I can understand that. We're all human. We all have weaknesses and embarrassing things that we wouldn't want anybody to reveal. What's your weakness?
It's stupid, and it doesn't really have anything to do with this too much. It's something I'm working through.
Do you have problems with your temper?
No.
Or anger issues?
No, it's nothing like that. I mean, I sometimes yell. Nothing like, I wouldn't go as far as saying anger. I think it's just because I come from a family that yelled at everyone.
That's how they communicate?
I think they're just sort of desensitized to it. Like, after I moved out, I was away for a while, so when I come back to visit, it's like, you don't need to yell, I'm standing right here. Or my mom will yell at my brother. Like, he's standing right there, you don't need to yell. And she's like, well, he doesn't listen if I don't yell. And the thing is, it's because he's become desensitized to her yelling, so until she yells, he's like, okay. Yeah, so it's something like that, but not anger. And I've been able to check that a lot, my yelling, because it's not a nice way to communicate, in my opinion, and it doesn't really help anything.
So how could things go so wrong? You know, I'm not understanding. If it's not jealousy, it's not an anger problem. You said you were afraid, or you nodded at least that you were afraid. But I'm not sure what you were afraid of. It may not be trivial to his parent or his grandmother. Brothers and sisters. And I think any information that they could have to help understand, you know, who you are and what transpired that day is going to help them. It won't bring their son back, but it will help them understand. And I don't understand why you wouldn't do that for them. Because you obviously care. not asking you to make excuses for yourself. Because I don't think you're the type of person that would do that. But I'm asking you to do something for somebody else. Somebody that deserves to know. What was it about your relationship with him that went so wrong that would end up like that? And if that wasn't your intention, then what was? You say that, you know, you said at one point when I posed the question to you about why you wouldn't do that for the family, and you said that was a good question and you think you will.
Are you sure I will?
Well, now's your time. This is the opportunity that I'm trying to give you.
I understand and I appreciate that.
Then what's keeping you from doing it?
I think I just need to sort through things still because I'm just not sure. They deserve the right answers.
They deserve to know what happened. You have those answers. You may not know the why within yourself, but you have those answers. You know what happened. You can still write them a letter when you figure out within yourself, you know, some of the questions that you're struggling with. But in the meantime, you can let them know what happened. The facts of what happened.
I don't have all the details.
What details do you have? Was he happy to see you when you got there that day? Or did he appear happy? Or was he angry that you showed up?
I don't